Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. So for this afternoon, so Panos Stinis is going to give the presentation. And so he's going to continue on the theme of Maurice Wansink, but discussing applications to PDEs and other related questions like renormalization and so on. Okay.
Thank you very much.
So Panos is from the Pacific Northwest National Lab.
Yes. So I want to thank, first of all the people who are attending. It's nice to have this first summer school. Hopefully there will be more to come. Okay, so if you're feeling a bit tired, I am tired too, and don't worry, this will probably put you to sleep, so you're fine. I won't try to wake you up. So the title, Problem Reduction, Memory and Renormalization, is in fact the order in which I want to talk about things. So I want to talk obviously about the problem of problem reduction, which means that we have some large system of equations and we would like to construct a smaller system of equations, but of course this is not as simple as it sounds because you have to account for the things that you want to throw out. So this will lead us to the concept of memory, as it was explained this morning and also the previous days by several people. And then I will go and examine cases which are actually very relevant because many real world problems fall in this category, where the memory that goes through Moritz Wansink is actually not enough. So in the sense that the formalism, the Moritz Wansink formalism itself breaks down. And you have to do something about it. And this will lead us to the third concept here, which is the concept of renormalization, which was initially developed in high energy physics to deal with infinities. And we will see that we have a similar concept here when we try to do model reduction for systems that are too large to simulate, that you can run into the same problem of infinities, but with an added complication, that for the problems that we are looking at, we have a time dependency too. So this creates an extra problem. We will see all these things. So it's the first time I have to present all this stuff, and I will not try to give you a lot of results, but try to go slowly through things and try to derive some things. And I think it's good to see them once in your life, so then you can claim, okay, I've seen it, I don't have to look at it again. All right, and then you can go and do all sorts of nice things with the wherever you want to apply it. So let's start with this very simple example that George also showed, just to introduce the idea that when you try to do model reduction, construct reduced order models, you will in general have memory showing up. So do we have anything to point, or just use our hand? Eric, you know? Do you have any?
Somebody had a pointer.
Okay. So let's start with a very simple linear differential system for two variables, x of t, y of t. Here they have initial condition x of 0, x sub 0, y of 0 equals y sub 0.
So actually, the hand is pretty good, you know.
Okay, I'm fine. As long as you don't mind, I mean.
No, you can use the pointer, but on the video, I think the head is easier to see. But it's okay.
Okay, yeah, all right. So, anyway, I'll use my hands. So, the idea is here is the following. I start with two ordinary differential equations. They're linear. These are very simple to solve. Actually, you don't need to do any reduction. You can just form the matrix of the system and diagonalize it and find the solution. But let's assume that you are strange people, and what you want to do is you want to take these two equations and write down an equation just for x of t, okay? Then, how do you do that? Well, obviously, you can solve this equation, which is linear. This is the homogeneous part of the equation here. And then you treat this as an inhomogeneous term. So you just solve it by the variation of constants, and you get the solution that y of t is actually y0 e to the minus t, and then you get the effect that comes from the history of x, okay? But then what do? You take this expression for y and you plug it in here. So then you get the equation dx dt is equal to x plus this thing here, which is y of t. Okay? So what does this mean? Well, this is the main thing to remember, that when you try to do reduction, it leads to memory effects. Okay? I mean, this is, as George said in the morning, it's one of the main things to take home from this summer school, because we have seen, even after so many years that people have been working with reduced order models, that not everybody understands that memory is important. Okay, let's just put it this way. But it is very important. And so this is just an example which shows this. So, okay, as other people said before, what we would like to do is we would like to find the formalism which allows us to generalize this observation, which holds for this simple linear system of two equations, to nonlinear systems of arbitrary but finite dimension. If you're interested at what happens if you have infinite dimensions, the answer is that in principle you can actually do this formalism, which I will show in a minute, also for the case of infinite dimensions, but things, instead of getting into PDEs, then you have to work with functional differential equations. So we don't care about that, because at the end of the day, when you want to do numerics, you put things in a computer and you discretize things and you work with systems of ODEs, and so the formalism will work fine. Okay, until it breaks down, as I said. All right, so such a formalism, luckily for us, exists, and it appeared first in the work of Zwanzig in 1961, and then in the work of Mori in 1965, and then it waited 35 years until 2000, when Chorin-Halde and Kupferman took this formalism, which was originally developed in the context of irreversible statistical mechanics, and they said, okay, the people use it there in order to reduce many body systems into fewer body systems, okay? So the idea was, why don't we do it for an arbitrary system of ODEs, okay? So that's how this work here started. And of course, a lot of things came after that when it comes to the reduced order models, and of course a lot of things have happened in the statistical physics community between 1961 and now, okay? All right, so let's start with what we have. Suppose that we are given a capital M dimensional system of ordinary differential equations whose solution I will write here specifically like this. So I have d phi u0 of t dt. So phi is a capital M dimensional vector, all right? And this r here is the right-hand side, which is in general nonlinear. So this is also an m-dimensional vector of the solution with initial condition phi of u0, 0, which is u0. Usually when people write down ordinary differential equation systems, they don't specify the dependence on the initial condition. Here I do it on purpose, because what I will do is that instead of trying to do the reduction directly on these systems of ODEs, instead what I will do is I will write down a PDE for all possible initial conditions. Okay? So that's why I wanted to write down the solution which depends on the specific initial condition, because I'm going to write down a PDE which depends on time and capital M, let's call them spatial dimensions. Okay, so you can imagine that if capital M for practical applications is in the order of billions, that's not the kind of PDE that you would like to solve, right? Okay, so I'll tell you what this PDE looks like and then I will derive it for you, okay? So instead, as I said, trying to do the reduction, so that's what the formalism does. Instead of doing the reduction directly at the level of the ordinary differential equations, it does this idea, it uses this idea, which is actually a pretty neat trick and used in many places in math, instead of working at one level, which is the level of ODEs, you go to a higher level, which is the level of PDEs. So what do you lose? What you lose is that you go from the discrete, from a finite dimensional system to a PDE, which is infinite dimensional system. But you gain, by doing this, you gain linearity. The moment you gain this linearity for this system of linear partial differential equations, then you can apply the formalism because linear operators we like, okay? Exactly because of the property of linearity. So, I have this system of ODEs and I write down, and I want to show you that solving this system of PDEs here, where capital L is a linear operator which involves, as you see here, the right-hand side from here, evaluated at the initial condition, I will show you that solving this thing, okay, for an arbitrary initial condition is equivalent to solving this PDE, okay? But I will never actually solve this PDE. What I will do is I will go from this level to this level, perform the reduction on the level of the PDE, and then go back to the ODEs, okay? Or, yes.
So can you explain more on the U0K a little bit? What is U0K?
Yes, so K is 1 to M, okay? U0K is the initial condition for the kth variable, okay? All right, so let's see now how do we go from here to here. And this is called, I'm just telling you this in case you have a background in physics, sometimes I didn't call it the Liouville operator, I just call it the Liouvillean operator, because the Liouville operator, which goes into the Liouville equation, is, as you see it, as you learn about it in physics, is the adjoint of this one. Okay, so I just call this Liouvillean because, oops, it is related to that operator. Okay, so let's derive this equation. And what am I going to do to derive it? So what I'm going to do is, instead of deriving an equation directly for this, I will derive, let's take here, g of u0. Remember always, whenever you see 0, we're referring to the initial condition, okay? So let g of u0 be any smooth function of the initial conditions, and define this new function, u of u0 comma t. So this is a function which depends on the m dimensions, okay, and time. And I define it to be the value of this function g at the value of the solution of the system of ODEs at time t, all right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to find a PDE which is satisfied by u, and this PDE will turn out to be the Liouvillean equation, okay? And then, in order to finally derive what I wanted here, I will specify the case when g is actually the identity to get finally the equation which I showed in the previous slide. The reason why, you may ask yourself, why do you have to go and define also this extra complication through this function g? The reason is that I want to show you that you can write down this equation, this linear equation, for any observable. Not necessarily just for the solution, but for any observable, which means any function of the solution. This is important for applications, especially if you work in physics, because sometimes you have, you're not just interested in the solution of a system of ODEs, but you want to compute things from it. So you may have to compute what people call collective variables, or what Zwanzig himself was interested in the first place, which was equations, which transport equations. All right, so really the derivation is just pure differentiations and chain rule, nothing else, okay? Assuming that we're talking about a system of ODEs where this is smooth enough. So let's just forget about any subtleties, assume that R is as smooth as you want it for all these things to hold, all right? So what do we do? We want to find an equation for this. Let's just differentiate it with respect to T, all right? And then we apply the chain rule, exactly by the definition here, we have that the derivative with respect to t of u is the sum over I dg du 0i, evaluated, of course, at phi, and then you have d dt of phi I u 0t, okay? Of course, then you take this here, and you use the definition that this is equal to Ri phi of ut, and you have this solution. So let's look at how this thing, which I have here, is very close to what I would like for the PDE. In fact, what I would like to show is that this right-hand side here, sigma of I, Ri phi u 0t dg du I, evaluated at phi, that what I can do, what I want to do, is I want to take this argument, okay, and from here, make it disappear, okay? So I want to make everything refer to the initial condition, all right? That's what we want to do. So we want to work on that, because the moment we get this identity, we can apply it here and we have our, and we have what we wanted. So let's see how we prove that. So in order to prove it, it's first we have to prove a useful identity, which we will later use to get what we wanted. So first we prove the identity that R evaluated at phi of u0, t is the Jacobian of phi times R of u0. This you may have seen also in courses in mechanics, but just for the sake of completeness, I'm just including a short proof here. So how do you do that? Well, what you can do if you want to prove that, you can define the difference between the left and the right hand side and prove that it is zero for all time, okay? So that's what we're going to do. Let's define the difference of the left hand side and the right hand side of 4, which I have it here. It's R of phi u 0t minus the right hand side here. So first of all, let's see if it holds at t equals 0, because if it doesn't hold at t equals 0, we're not going anywhere, okay? So for t equals 0, what do we have? We have f of u 0, 0, and here I have r evaluated at phi of u 0, 0 minus d u, with respect to u 0, phi of u 0, again, t becomes 0, and r u 0, all right? But remember what I showed you before here, that the initial condition phi of u0, 0 is u0. So the moment you have that, it means that this thing here is u0. So the Jacobian becomes the identity matrix, and then these two things cancel and you get 0. All right? So at least for time t equals 0, this identity holds. So let's see if it holds for later. The way to do it is that we will find the equation of how this capital F evolves, and we will show that it is a linear equation, so if it starts from the value 0, it has, the solution has to remain 0 for all time, okay? So this is just a tedious exercise in chain rule, so since we have a lot of things to cover, I just put it here for the sake of completeness. I want to find an equation for the evolution of this capital F u0t. If you go through this and you just apply the chain rule and the definition of what is the derivative of phi, okay, that this thing is the right-hand side, finally, you go down here these steps and you find that the rate of change of f is equal to this times f itself. So this is a linear equation for f. So from 7, which is this, that f of u0 at 0 is 0, and from 8, which is this, which tells you that f of u0, t satisfies a linear equation, you're done. Because you have a linear equation which starts from the initial condition 0, so the solution is 0 for all time, okay? So that's how we got this useful identity. And here, now we're one step, now that we have this identity, we're one step from finally proving the getting the PDE that we wanted. Because what can we do now with this identity? Remember, we had this expression and we wanted to get this argument and transform it into u0. But that's exactly what we're going to do here, because for each one of these components, now that I have, I apply the identity that I just proved in here, okay? And then basically you rearrange the two summations, which you can do. It's fine because everything here is finite. You just have finite sums. There is no problem in rearranging the summations. And the moment you rearrange the summations, you realize that this expression here in parentheses is nothing else but the derivative of g with respect to uij to u0j, and you got finally what you wanted. So, in other words, what I proved is this here, identity, all right? I proved this thing. So now that this holds, it means that I can take this right-hand side and plug it in here and finally get the equation that I wanted. So from 2 and 3, we conclude that this function that I defined, which is u of u0, comma t, solves this equation, which is exactly the equation I mentioned in the first slide, that I wanted, okay? And of course, by the definition, at time 0, u of u0, comma 0 is exactly g evaluated at u0, and L is this differential operator, which I called the Euclidean type operator. Now, assuming, as I said, that you have all the nice properties in the world for R, which allow you to define L so that L is the generator of an evolution operator of the semigroup, then you can define this semigroup e to the TLG of U0, which is what? When it gets applied to any function G of the initial condition, it returns the value of that function at the current, evaluated at the solution at the current time. Okay? And finally, to get the equation that I wanted, I just apply the case for g of u0 is equal to u0, and we finally get the equation which is going to be the starting point for the whole Moritz-Banzig formalism. Okay? So what did I get? I had a system of ODEs, and I transformed it into a system of linear PDEs. That's the key here, that these are linear PDEs, and we will see exactly how this is used. Now, if you have some background in probability, or again, in statistical physics, this you may have seen in a stochastic context, this equation. There it is called the backward Kolmogorov equation, which is for the evolution of observables. There is also the forward Kolmogorov equation, which is for the evolution of the probability density. In our case, we don't have a stochastic system, but the forward Kolmogorov equation is just what people call the Liouville equation in physics, which is the evolution equation for the density, and the evolution operator is going to be the adjoint of L. All right. So I'm just saying this for terminology, because sometimes things get confused. People talk in terms of stochastic systems. We talk here in terms of deterministic systems, and there may be confusion. All right. So now we're one step from getting the Moritz-Banzig formula, and then we can start playing around with it. So as people explained before, let's assume that here I have the initial conditions and in general my variables, and I take my variables and I break them into two parts. Let's call it the u0 hat, which I will call the resolved variables, and the u0 tilde, which are called the unresolved variables. So remember that initially we had capital M dimensions. Let's assume that capital N dimensions are the one that we're going to resolve, and then M minus N will be the unresolved variables, okay? Now, the Moritz-Banzig formalism, like any other formalism that uses some kind of projection, well, you need to define a projection operator, okay? Which means what? That you start with all the variables of the system, and then you want to construct equations for a subset of these variables. So, if you want to do that, if you want to perform this operation of going from the many variables to the few variables, you have to do some kind of projection there, okay? Which translates mathematically into what? That if you start from any function, let's call this space of functions of U0 with this script f, okay, you need some kind of a projection operator which will get you from here to the space of functions of only the resolved variables, all right? So also, since we define p, we can define the complement, which is q, which is I minus p, and then we take the equation that we have derived, the linear PDE that we have derived, let's say for the kth component, okay? So remember that this equation is L e to the TL U0. Instead of, in front of L, I write the identity, which is equal to P plus Q. Then I break it into two parts, okay? Then I keep this part, and then here I have the stuff that is the evolution of the things that were initially orthogonal to the space of the functions that I, of the variables that I want to keep, all right? So for this thing, you just use Dyson's formula called in physics, Duhamel's principle called in math, which is right here, which says that e to the TL, this operator, can be broken down as e to the TQL, which is another operator for what we will call the orthogonal dynamics, plus an interaction term, okay? So this is nothing else but the formula that you get from the variation of constants, okay? So it's just a sophisticated way of writing the variation of constants. Okay, so here is finally the Moritz-Wanzig equation, which, as you will have understood by now, it's nice, we write it down, it's an exact reformulation, we haven't made any approximation yet, okay? However, exactly because it's so elegant and so general, it hides all the dirty details that come when you actually have to apply it. And in fact, you may say that it doesn't even hide much the dirty details, because you see two things. Initially, you had one evolution operator, which was e to the TL, where L, if you remember, has to do with the dynamics of the whole system. Now, there is a new operator here, which is e to the TQL, all right, which does what? This, as we will see, we have to find out what kind of equation this thing satisfies, all right? So this we're going to do now. So if you write down e to the TQL, QL U0K as WK, then you find that this quantity here exactly satisfies an equation which looks a lot like the one we had before. So remember, this equation that we had for the full system is e to the TL U0 L e to the TL U0. Now, we have an equation here, a PDE, a linear PDE. However, this operator is not L, but QL. Since P projects on the things, on the variables that we want to resolve, QL goes on the orthogonal complement, okay? So, and look at the initial condition. The initial condition for this particular equation is QL U0K, which means that the initial condition lives in the space which is orthogonal to the space on which we project. But it's not only that. It's that the solution of 13 is of this one here, it's very easy to prove just by taking the projection, is at all times orthogonal to the range of P, okay? And that is why it is called the orthogonal dynamics equation. Now, just to make a connection with what you may have heard about Langevin equations and noise terms and things like that, the orthogonal dynamics equation would be the equation for the evolution of the noise. Okay, think of it this way. So, however, this equation here is the beginning of all the trouble when it comes to model reduction. And why is that? Actually, there is a very concrete mathematical reason which I write here. The difficulty with the orthogonal dynamics equation is that in general, it cannot be written as a closed equation for WK. Which means that you actually have to solve it as a PDE. If you want to solve it, you have to solve it as a PDE. Of course, you may say, wait a minute, you're cheating here, because before you wrote down a PDE here, and you wrote down a PDE here for the resolved variables. So now, why do you have a problem with writing down another PDE for the orthogonal dynamics equation? Well, the reason is that I was never planning on solving this as a PDE, okay? I wanted this just to do the projection and perform the reduction. In the end, I would end up solving ODEs. However, here is the catch, which of course is something that you should have expected, that you cannot just break a system into two parts and hope to get away with it without doing a lot of work, okay? So the difficulty exactly that comes is this, that you have to solve this equation as a PDE in dimension capital M. Remember what we said before, if capital M is in the order of millions or billions, good luck, right? So this is what sometimes people call the law of conservation of trouble, okay? That you try to do something which is will help you, and you realize that you cannot escape because you cannot just throw things away. However, there is no reason to be pessimistic about this, because the nice thing about the Moritz-Wanzig formulas is not, as I said, that we're going to solve things on this level, but this is a good starting point for approximations that are going to be based on all sorts of observations, mathematical, numerical, physical, etc. So, and this is what I write here, that this is a good starting point of approximations, and you can construct reduced models based on mathematical, physical, and numerical observation. And here comes this very nice property, which comes from the fact that this formalism is a reformulation of the original problem without any approximations. The models that you will get from here, if you use it as a starting point for approximations, these models come directly from the original equations, and the terms appearing in the models are not introduced by hand. If you go out and look at the literature on model reduction, there are many, 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 many models, and for many of them, there is no justification of where the different terms came from. It's what people call introduced by hand. People thought, okay, why don't I add a term of this form? It looks like a nice term, so it has nice properties, why don't I add it? Well, that's the nice thing about this formalism, that it goes beyond this, because it actually dictates itself what should these terms be like in the reduced model. Of course, there is a catch, that it dictates terms that can be expensive to compute. However, it's better to have a controlled approximation than just adding terms by hand, okay? Even if you add terms by hand and they end up working, you can never be sure that what about the next term? What other terms can I add? Here, at least you know that there is a systematic way of improving your approximation, but it may be very expensive to do, okay? All right, so now that we have seen these things, before I make any approximations, let's go and derive the two fluctuation dissipation theorems, the first kind and the second kind. In order to do that, I will assume that I have, for the system that I'm interested in, I have access to the probability density function of the initial conditions, which, let's say, is given by this rho of u0, okay? Now, the reason I want a PDF is to do the calculations. It's easier for the calculations that I will do. However, you could have also access to the measure without necessarily admitting a density. So the important thing, as we said, since Moritz-Wanzig formalism is a projection formalism, is that you have to define some kind of a projection, all right? So the question is, what projection are we going to use? You can use any kind of projection you want. In fact, you have to understand something, that since this equation, where is it here? Since this equation here is a reformulation, it doesn't care about what projection you're going to use. Because if you use a projection which does not put enough information on this term, the slack will have to be picked up by the other two terms. You see, the amount of information on the right-hand side is the same. How you decide to break it up, it's up to you. If you do a very good job with the projection P, you put here as much information as you can, then the memory term and this thing which is called the noise term will have a relatively easy job to do. If on the other hand you use a very simple projection which basically captures nothing, then all the information will have to be taken care of by that. In fact, I have worked with systems where for other reasons the projection that was used made this term to be zero. So basically you ended up getting a reduced system where it had just memory and noise. This term, the first term, the Markovian, had no contribution. That is not easy, I can tell you, because then you can expect that you can have a long memory and the noise term will not be easy to, but I just had to do it because people wanted the projection to look like that, so it wasn't my choice. All right, so here there are two projections that are popular. Well, actually three projections, but the third one is a special case of the second one. So the first is the conditional expectation. If you have a function f of u0, the conditional expectation of f of u0 conditioned on the hat, remember hat is the resolve variables, okay? It's just given by this integral of f with respect to the tilde variables, and of course you have to divide by this to normalize things, okay? And why do people like the conditional expectation? Because, as you know, the conditional expectation is the best in an L2 sense, meaning that if you take any function h of the resolved variables, the the mean square error that you commit when you approximate f by the conditional expectation is less or equal than the mean square error for any other function h, okay? So this is why people like conditional expectation, and in many cases it is actually a very good projection.
So I have a question. I thought like previously you said gu equal to u.
Yes.
That is like implicitly you said the projection is like you have a full variable project on the resolve variable, which
yes.
is, that's the projection you already defined.
You don't define the projection of, you define a projection of functions of all the variables on functions of the resolved variables.
Yes, but I think you define a function as gu equal to u. Then
yes.
You define a p gu equal to u hat.
I did
right?
No. I didn't have g. I had here this. That if these are the functions of u0,
okay.
The projection takes you from a function of u0 to a function of u hat. Okay? G was just any collective variable which is a function of all the variables. So it has nothing to do with it. It's a separate thing. It has nothing to do with the projection.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So the second most popular projection is what is called the finite rack projection. So if you want to define the finite rack projection, first, instead of taking any possible function of the resolved variables, you concentrate only on the square integrable functions of the resolved variables. Okay? So you denote the space of square integrable functions of u hat 0 as l hat 2. All right? And then you assume that if you have an orthonormal set of basis functions, all right, which here is what I mean by orthonormal, that with respect to this density rho, okay, they're orthogonal, and also the square, when you integrate it with respect to them, I mean, against themselves, they give you one, okay? So with respect to the PDF rho of u0. Then the finite rank projection says that if you keep only L terms from this infinite basis, okay, and you take that P of F of U0 is a linear combination of those, this is called the finite rank projection, okay? So you realize here that this is a nice thing and a bad thing at the same time. It's a nice thing because you have a systematic way of adding higher and higher terms. However, if U hat of 0 here is of high dimension, obviously, these orthonormal bases will quickly how many the terms that you need to keep explode, right? Combinatorially, the number of terms that you have to keep. However, it is a convenient projection because you can order the terms, while here in the conditional expectation, it's an integral. I mean, you have to approximate the integral. Here, you do somehow a more systematic approximation.
But it's kind of hard for you. You had to be high dimensional, right? Because, I mean, the cost of, for example, I mean, the conditional expectation becomes very difficult to calculate anyway.
No. It is. Both of them are very...
Right.
Yes. In fact, that's why... Now, if you keep, let's say, that H1 is the linear function, then you get the famous linear projection. Okay, so that's what I write here.
Right.
So if we keep only the linear terms in the expansion, and I said linear terms because you can have more than one dimensions, okay, then we get the so-called linear projection, which is the most popular. In fact, that's the one originally used by Mori, as was explained by, you explained it before, right? And also in the first papers by Spansik, I think he also used only the linear projection. Yes, the reason I have it like that is because the projection is linear anyway. The fact of calling it linear projection is a bit strange. It's just that a fast way of saying doing a projection and keeping only the linear terms, okay? But any projection is linear. Now, here I have in parentheses here something very important, that when people were using the linear projection, what does it mean? It means that I have here a function originally of all the variables, and I approximate it by a linear function of the resolved variables. So if that is the case, if I need only the linear terms in this projection here, this means that somehow you're not moving away from equilibrium. Because if you move away from equilibrium, you will have more complicated dependence on the resolved variables. So in fact, we're going to use that right now to derive the fluctuation dissipation theorem of the first kind, okay? So let's see how this thing.
Just a quick
question.
So does rho here, you assume it's invariant?
Not yet, okay. I don't have to, but I will give you a proposition of how it helps when it is invariant.
Okay,
so wait a couple of slides. All right. So, what does the fluctuation dissipation theorem of the first kind say? It says, sometimes it's called also Onsager's principle, which says the following, that if you are close to equilibrium, if you look at the decay of an equilibrium correlation, and if you look at the decay of a non-equilibrium quantity towards equilibrium, you cannot tell which is which. Okay, meaning that if you are close to equilibrium, it's a nice thing. It's a nice thing because basically, not the decay from non-equilibrium to equilibrium is resembles just the decay of equilibrium fluctuations. Okay, so this is nice because it helps you with modeling and everything. So this is what we're going to show, which is very easy to show through the Moritz-Banzig formalism. Okay. So let's assume, for the sake of simplicity, that you just have one resolved variable, okay, U01, that's the initial condition, and you keep only the linear term in the projection. So when I take P of F of U0, it's just of F, U01, that's the projection coefficient, times U01, where we have assumed that the normalization is 1, okay, so that I don't have to carry around.
In the parenthesis is the expectation.
Yes, it's the expectation, yes. I keep forgetting to say that all these things are with respect to rho. Okay? Yes, everywhere you see here... here. Okay. Everywhere you see these things, these are inner products, just... Which I think I didn't define it right. Yes, sorry about that. I should have written it. Okay, so let's take the equation for this one resolved variable, all right, with the linear projection. This is what it looks like. We have the rate of change is equal to the, we have the first term, we have the second term, and we have the memory, all right? However, exactly because I'm using the projection which uses only the linear term on the one variable, this here, it PL U01 is equal to L U01 comma U01, and of course E to the TL passes through that because this is just a function of time, so this thing, this operator doesn't care about that, and goes and gives you this. This we don't touch, it's fine. And again, we do here, we apply this definition of the projection on the memory term, and we have this projection coefficient and e to the t minus sl u01. All right? So what you say? Okay, we're going to do something more with it. Now let's take the inner product of 15 with u01. So I go in the previous equation and I take the inner product with u01. And I have L u01, u01. Here I have this. Here I have that, which is the correlation here of the orthogonal dynamics with u01. And I think I forgot to put it here. Sorry. Sorry about that. I forgot to write it here too, but I have written it below. Okay. So let's see what happens, first of all. This term here is zero. Why is that? Because, like we said, this is the orthogonal dynamics equation. So it's always orthogonal to the range of the projection, but the projection is on functions of u01. So if I try to project on u01, I get zero. All right? So this term goes away. So I'm left with the first term and with the second, with the third term here. All right? So now I stop and I make the following observation. What is this thing? This is an autocorrelation. This is the autocorrelation here. E to the TL U01, U01. This is exactly the autocorrelation of the resolved variable. So I found for this particular choice of projection, which keeps only the linear term, the evolution equation for the autocorrelation, okay? Now, I can do one more thing. I can multiply again with u01. Why is that? Because the projection itself, by definition, is equal here. If you take the projection of the first variable, of the evolution of the first variable on the initial condition, you get exactly that coefficient, which is what? It's the autocorrelation times u01. So if you take this equation and you multiply it with u01, what do you get? You get basically the same equation. So I just put it one below the other. So here is the equation for the evolution of the projection on the resolved variable, and here is the equation for the evolution of the autocorrelation. But look, what are these things? They're exactly the same equation. If someone gives you the solution of this equation, you don't know if you're looking at the decay of an autocorrelation or if you're looking at the decay of this, which is a non-equilibrium quantity towards equilibrium. So this is exactly what I'm writing here, that these are the same equations, and this is exactly the fluctuation dissipation theorem of the first kind. So you see, in a very simple way, how if you use just what people call the linear projection, which means keep only the linear terms of the projection, how it is easy to derive the fluctuation dissipation theorem of the first kind, or otherwise called Donzager's principle, without doing any sophisticated approximations. It's just that it's all given to you by the formalism and the definition of the projection.
Well, very nice derivation.
Yes, yeah. Simple. Now let's derive the second one. So fluctuation dissipation theorem of the second kind. So this one is the one that says that the autocorrelation of the noise is related to the kernel of the memory term. All right? So, and here I will answer your question about the invariant measure, because we will see that it's important. So assume that P now is the finite rank projection.
Now, since the quantity e to the tql, ql u01, this is the orthogonal dynamics equation, starts and stays in the space orthogonal to the range of p, what does it mean? It means that if I take here this and I write in front of it the identity as p plus q, p, when it gets applied, it gives you zero, because you know that it lives on a space which is orthogonal to the range of p. So e to the tql is equal to the projection on the orthogonal complement, okay? So why do I want to do that? Well, you'll see that because here I have this, which is the, just to remind you, let me go back here. This here is the kernel that goes into the memory, all right? So I will be manipulating this term. So PL e to the SQLQL, I just insert here the Q, which I'm allowed to do exactly because of this property of the orthogonal dynamics equation, all right? And now I use the fact that I have chosen the finite rank projection. So what do I have? I have that this projection of this quantity, okay, is equal to the sum from J equals 1 to L. These are the projection coefficients, okay, times Hj U0, all right? Now we come to the question that Felix had. Now, for if this density rho that I've been talking about of the initial conditions is the Boltzmann distribution for a Hamiltonian system, okay, we know, and we use it to define the inner product, then the operator L is skew symmetric. So what does this mean if it's skew symmetric? It means that in this inner product, you can bring this thing over here, but you have to take out the minus, okay? And of course, the moment you bring this over here, then you can bring Q, because Q is fine, it's symmetric, so it can just go over here, all right? So then what you have? You would have the sum. So that's why people, these things were developed initially for Hamiltonian systems, and people used the Boltzmann distribution to define the inner products, this skew symmetry is given to you, okay? So then if you bring L over here and you bring Q over here with the minus, as we will see, then this thing becomes correlations of the orthogonal dynamics. Okay, we'll see this in the next slide. However, what I want to say here is that even though we have seen this property of skew symmetry holding for Hamiltonian systems when you use the Boltzmann distribution, there is a very simple proposition, in fact it's a few lines to prove, that this holds more generally. That if you have any system, not necessarily a Hamiltonian system, and if the density that you use to define the inner product is invariant, and you use as a projection the finite rank one, then the operator L is skew symmetric. Okay? So why is this a nice thing? Because this is what will give us the fluctuation dissipation theorem of the...
So hold on, can you explain why it's automatically skew symmetric?
Ah, you just take the definition of You can just take the inner product.
Or you say integration by parts?
Yes, integration by parts. And because it is invariant, there is a term there that you want it to go away and it goes to zero.
Oh, yeah,
yes. So for Hamiltonian systems, if you use the Boltzmann distribution, you have the skew symmetry. If you have now an arbitrary system and you use, somehow you're so clever that you have found the invariant distribution, and you use as a projection the finite rank one, then the operator L is also skew symmetric. So if these things hold, then we have exactly what I said before, okay, that we can bring L over here, take a minus out, the Q comes over here because Q is symmetric, so all the memory kernels become correlations of different orders, but correlations of what? Of the orthogonal dynamics, okay? And what is the orthogonal dynamics? As we said, it's the noise. Okay, so in particular, if we look at the linear function h of u0 hat equals to u0k, we have the noise autocorrelation, which is this thing. That is exactly the fluctuation dissipation theorem of the second kind. And moreover, Because when you have the autocorrelation with the minus, what does this mean? It means that this term becomes a dissipative term. So the minus sign means that in this case, the memory term is dissipative in nature. Thus, here we come exactly to the concept of fluctuation dissipation theorem. The noise term, meaning the fluctuations, are related to the memory term, which is the dissipation. That is exactly the fluctuation dissipation theorem of the second kind, which is, as you know, and as you have seen also in this summer school, very popular in statistical physics and molecular dynamics. Okay? So up to now, I have made no approximations, but now it's time to start going into approximations, because all these things are nice, but they don't tell us how to actually compute things. Okay? So, the first, I will do two classifications of systems. The first classification is according to the time scales that are present in the system. The second one will come later, okay? And so, there are three main cases that if you look around the literature, you will find. You have the case where, I have to just go back here just to explain, because it may look a bit suspicious what I'm saying. All right, so let's look back at this equation here, the memory term. So let's look at the memory term. The memory term involves two operators, right? There is this operator which we have said a lot of things about, the orthogonal dynamics operator, and there is this operator which is the full dynamics operator, okay? Now these things, obviously, they don't have to operate on the same time scale, right? This could be slower than that, this could be slower than this, or they could be on comparable time scales, right? So this is the time scale classification that I mentioned here. That the resolved variables could evolve at a time scale which is slower, longer than the ones for the unresolved variables. So as far as the resolved variables are concerned, the unresolved variables look like noise. Now you can have the other case, where the resolved variables evolve much faster than the unresolved variables, okay? And then you have the case, which is actually the case which interests us and a lot of other people, because it appears a lot in applications, where you have no time scale separation. What does this mean? No time scale separation means that you have a large enough system that the fastest of the resolved variables evolves on a time scale which is comparable with the slowest of the unresolved, because you don't have enough computational power to bring down to scales which really anything you leave out evolves much faster. Because you have finite computational power, but the problem that you try to solve is so large, you may end up having this situation, not you may end up, many times it happens, for example, in all kinds of atmospheric dynamics, where there is no time scale separation between the resolved variables and the unresolved variables.
And okay? Here's an example of the one on the right, because that looks very unusual.
Yes, but...
Give me an example.
This is not something that you would like to do.
Oh, I'll just give you an example. I've never seen the one like that.
I think that one example that I have seen like that, remember the rabbit distortion theory in turbulence?
Yeah, I know.
That's a case of that, because you take the small scales and you force them by the large scales, which are much slower. Yes.
Or adiabatic dynamics, I can imagine a gradual force on a system.
Okay.
You have an empty simulation that fluctuates.
And then you have
external
forcing. External forcing, which is much slower. Yes.
Dynamics.
Yes.
Or
yes.
Pressure.
Yeah. So the fact that there exists this classification, it doesn't mean that we want to be in this case, right? Not necessarily. Okay. So let's look first at the short time and what is related, the short memory approximations, which makes a connection with all these things that you have seen this morning about the Markovian approximation and so on. So I will make an approximation here, which I will call the short time approximation. And as you will see, under certain assumption, it becomes also a short memory approximation. Okay? So let's start by rewriting Dyson's formula. So we remember in Dyson's formula, we had e to the TL is equal e to the TQL plus. So I just bring the memory term on this side with a minus, all right? A short time approximation is the following. You say, okay, you told me that the orthogonal dynamics equation is so hard to solve. So why don't I try to cheat a little bit and maybe I can do it for a short time. That's why it's called the short time approximation. So I make the following approximation that for a short time, instead of solving the orthogonal dynamics equation, I can get away by solving the full dynamics. Why is that? Because I may have access to solving the full dynamics equation just by evolving my system many times, okay? But constructing the PDE in a billion dimensions that I need to solve to get the orthogonal dynamics is something that I don't want to do, okay? So, in other words, we replace the flow in the orthogonal complement of F with the flow induced by the full system operator L. This, for example, you could get, you could have a black box that produces these things, okay? But getting this thing is very hard, okay? But for a short time, it's not a bad idea, okay, to make this approximation of this by that. So, as I write here in the remark, unless there is a special structure of the full system, we expect this approximation to be valid only for short times. So the question is, how accurate is it, such an approximation? Well, okay, let's see how accurate it is. Let me start with the memory, and I want to see how accurate this approximation is. So first, what I do is, in front of this e to the SQL, I make an identity appear, so that you're not in any kind of anticipation. I can tell you it's of order t to the cube, so let's just go and find it now. Okay, so let's see what we have. We have p plus q, and as we said before, p e to the SQL gives us zero, so I'm left with this. And like this. This thing is zero because it's a projection of the orthogonal dynamics, okay? Now, what I can do here is I can take plq e to the SQL qlu zero k, okay? Which, and remember what I want to do. I want to do the approximation, make the approximation of e to the SQL by e to the SL. So if I want this, I write what I would like to have, and then of course I have the difference of the two. Okay? All right. So here, the moment I have this, and given the fact that I'm looking only at short times, okay, if I assume that all these things are well behaved, I can expand this series, this difference, in a Taylor series, okay? And I have that it gives me minus SPL plus order S squared, okay? And of course, when I apply the Q, this doesn't change. It remains of order S squared. It's just that this term goes away because it's Q times P, which is zero, all right? So if we put this back, so if we take this approximation here and we put it back in here and we do the integration, and okay, I wanted to have also the finite rank projection, that's fine. Let's take the P, which is the finite rank projection, so I make this approximation here. I mean the projection, the finite rank approximation. Then I do the approximation of e to the SQL by e to the SL. I put it inside here, in the, what do you call it, in the memory kernel. I do the integration for the S order S squared term. And what do I get? Sorry about that. This should have been T, just T. I made a mistake. It will be T0 later, but okay. So anything you see here, instead of T0, it should be T, right? So this approximation of instead of working with the orthogonal dynamics operator, you work with the full dynamics operator, is an order T cubed, okay? So, as we expected, it wasn't going to be a very good approximation for all times, right? I mean, so, but can it be a good approximation? Yes. So, look what happens. Let's assume that these actual, the correlations here, decay after some time t0, they decay basically to zero, all right, after some time t0. Then, instead of having the integrals going from zero to t, I can have the integrals going from zero to t0. So then the approximation becomes of order t0 cubed. So you see, this short time approximation, which takes, instead of the orthogonal dynamics operator, it tells you, bring me these molecular dynamic solvers that you have, and you will provide me with the full dynamics, it can become a very good approximation. In fact, the smaller t0 is, order t0 cubed is not bad at all, okay? So the short time approximation is valid for large times if t0 is small. On the other hand, if t0 is large, then the error is of order t to the cubed, and the approximation, of course, is only valid for short times, okay? Now, what is the extreme case of that? Well, the extreme case of that is if t0 goes close to zero. This means that basically the memory decays to zero, the memory kernel decays to zero after almost no time, okay? So the extreme case of that is the famous delta function approximation or Markovian approximation, for which you saw a lot of results. However, if you don't have a delta function approximation, but you have some t0 which is small, there it is. This is the short memory approximation, okay, for which you saw a lot of results this morning, for a short memory approximation, which is not necessarily a delta function approximation, but you keep here, the way I have written things here, S is equal to zero corresponds to the current time, and you only have to keep back the history for T0 units of time. So if T0 is small, that's actually a pretty efficient scheme. And moreover, why is it nice? Because to compute these things here that you need, you could do it by doing calculations of the full system. You don't have to solve the orthogonal dynamics equation. So you have taken something which was practically impossible when you were looking at it, and you see that if you have this special structure in your system where the correlations decay fast, you can actually compute the memory kernels by doing calculations on the full dynamics, not the orthogonal dynamics, which is an extreme, very welcome simplification. Okay, and so that is the exact memory. And as I said, there is the time scale classification where you have resolved variables slower than the unresolved, no time scale separation, or the unresolved variables slower than the resolved. The simplest possible approximation for the first case that we have examined so far is if we take this case here, and if T0 is basically going to zero, then you can extend this integral from zero to infinity, because basically you don't, the kernel is practically zero, so you don't add to it anything. So the simplest possible approximation is also what Chang Ho showed this morning, which is the delta function, the delta memory. Okay, so where you extend this integral from zero to infinity, because the memory kernels in here decay so fast to zero that basically even if you extend the integration from t0 all the way to infinity, you add nothing to it. Okay? So there is the case now, in the other extreme, when the unresolved variables are slower than the resolved variables, which is the case where George asked about. The simplest case here is if you go to infinite memory. Okay? So you have the delta memory, and then you have the infinite memory, which is the other extreme. How can you compute things in this extreme? Well, what does it mean to have an infinite memory? Well, let's look at what it means. Just look at the here. Where is it? Here. What does it mean to have an infinite memory? It means that basically the full dynamics can jump around, they can do whatever they want. The orthogonal dynamics don't move at all. Okay? So imagine having this thing here moving around like crazy, and there is a thing here that moves extremely slowly. So basically, the movement of this thing doesn't make much of a difference. I mean, because you know that more or less it's going to be somewhere here. So that means an infinite memory. What would be the simplest approximation for that? Well, just take it constant. So what does this mean? Just take the expansion of this thing for s is equal to zero and keep the zero order term, which is the identity. Then you get exactly this expression here, that the memory becomes e to the t minus sl plql u0k. You see? No orthogonal dynamics. They have disappeared. So what do you have here? You keep here, but you pay the price that the integral goes from 0 to t. So as you move, you have a simple thing to evaluate, because this is not hard to compute even for complicated systems, but you can never stop the memory. So you have to keep a longer and longer and longer memory. That's why it's called an infinite memory. Okay, but it's easy. It's just that you will run out of out of computational power if you want to go for a long time. Okay, and since we have to stop now, right? It's 3:15.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So I'll stop the first lecture here. I will continue. What remains is the absence of time scale separation, for which I will show that one of the simplest approximations is what we will call the T model, and then we will try to go beyond the T model and see what happens there. Okay. So that would be the beginning of the next lecture. All right. Thank you very much.
So we'll have the second part after the break. So any questions?
Yep.
For the derivation of the first a kind of a fluctuating discipline theorem, mm-hmm. it shows that the relaxation to the equilibrium is really like the autocorrelations.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, does this really have some implication about the time reversibility of the system? Does it mean that
it tells you that if you're close to equilibrium, you cannot tell. You cannot tell. It the system, you may have things decaying from a non-equilibrium prepared state to equilibrium. It's just that when you measure it, you cannot tell. So to you, it could be a reversible system. That's what it says. That when you're close to equilibrium, you could mistake the system as being at equilibrium, as far as correlations are concerned.
Okay.
That's I have a question related
yes.
to something that we do all the time. And,
right.
And, so this is on the second fluctuation dissipation theorem.
Yeah.
So the linear term shows that you're implicitly very close to equilibrium, but it's a linear term, just not far from the equilibrium.
Yes, yes.
But in many different methods, Stokesian dynamics, by gradient contact, lots of other people, we use the second fluctuation dissipation theorem way far from equilibrium.
Yes, but here.
So,
yes, here
so
I use it.
How would you compromise this idea?
No. That's fine. That's fine. Here it is. It's here. All the memory kernels, not just the linear one, all the memory kernels become correlations of different orders of what? Of quantities that have to do with the noise. So what we call fluctuation dissipation theorem of the second kind refers only to the noise autocorrelation. But all the other terms, higher order terms if you use, they can also become correlations, not autocorrelations, but correlations of the orthogonal dynamics, which are correlations of the noise of different orders.
I know, but we don't use that part. That's what I'm saying. I mean, we don't involve
them. You have to use it. I have examples where if you don't use it, I mean, that's what I did also in my thesis. I showed that the linear is not enough.
I mean,
yeah.
The construction, as I said, all the stochastic methods, I don't know if anybody would
Well, I, there are also very
simple correlations. No, you know,
there is right, but I'm saying the fact that they don't use it doesn't mean that they shouldn't use it. So I have, I mean, there are simple examples of Hamiltonian systems where if you don't use it, if you don't use these higher order terms and the higher order correlations, you don't get good answers. I'm talking about systems with just two degrees of freedom, not nothing complicated. So that's in fact in the paper by Chorin, Halden, Kupferman from 2002.
No, I know they have like the three or four degrees of freedom, but this
it's a two oscillators, two oscillators non-linearly coupled.
Yeah, yeah.
Where there is no absence of there is an absence of time scale separation, and there you have to use higher order terms. So there is no inconsistency. The only thing that this tells you is that yes, as far as the linear term is concerned, you do get the fluctuation dissipation theorem of the second kind, but also higher order memory kernels are also related to higher order correlations of the noise, but they're not autocorrelations anymore. That's it. So, but what I wanted to say here was that there is a connection between the two. Now, whether you're going to use it if you have accurate enough computations, that's a different issue. But and whether you will need it, it depends on the system.
For example, the Stokes and dynamics have been around and been used a lot for different applications.
Yes.
They just use this straight second order correlations.
Yes.
And they use it at shear rates of extremely high shear rates.
Yeah.
For some lubrication problems.
Right.
So they seem to get the right answer. I don't know.
I'm very glad if people get the right answer.
How are the correlations? That's the thing. I'm trying to see what. Is it because you have extremely nonlinear system? What is that?
There has to be some reason for
non-Gaussian system.
There has to be something happening there that makes these correlations very small. Actually, make them small. They're small numbers. So adding them, if you don't have them with very accurately, it's just like adding noise. So why add them in the first place? I've seen this happening too in Hamiltonian systems. That. You can have quickly these higher order autocorrelations, correlations, quickly becoming, they could be small. So if you don't, as you said, it's very difficult to compute them accurately. So if you just compute them and they're not accurate, it's better not to put them at all because they may give you instabilities. But there are cases where they are needed. In fact, it could be the worst case is if you have sparsity there, meaning the first one is important and then the 10th one and then the 13th and then the 20th. So I tried at some point finding how many terms to keep by taking this matrix of the possible correlations and trying to do some something like a singular value decomposition, trying to see what are the main ones. But and that's why I'm talking about sparsity, because that's the kind of thing that I saw there, that maybe the first one is dominant, then there are a few of them that are not very important, and then there is another one later on that becomes important. So, yeah. Okay. Any other question?
Okay, so let's take a break here.